You are watching DHTV from California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Hello and welcome to IDS 318, Immigration in the United States. Hello, my name is Mike Fraga, and I'm a guide to the course that attempts to appreciate something about the immigrant population in general, and most important, the Mexican and Central American immigrant populations in specific. One of the reasons why we have a course like this is because the historical experiences of the diverse immigrant populations that created and to continue to create the economic and social foundation of the United States is crucial to understand, especially today. And so what we're going to attempt to do in this course is try to follow the legal steps that an immigrant must follow in order to achieve citizenship. But what we're going to be doing is appreciating, again, the different dimensions to this immigrant experience. So this course explores immigration policy and its effects on the different immigrant communities in the United States, but most importantly, in its impact on the Chicano, Mexicano, Latino communities in specific and U.S. society as a whole. So for those of you out in the cable audience, there is an 800 number that is available for you. And by all means, please call in if you have any questions or comments about the topics that will be covered today. Students, likewise, if you can, call in. Let me know. Let me hear your voices. And please take advantage of the online address and chat with me as we explore concepts for this course. Now, today's session will be covering the native dimension to immigration and citizenship, but it's been a couple of weeks since we've had this course. Simply last week we had a holiday. But let's find out what's been happening to the immigrant experience. So crew, if you can run those series of clips, let's appreciate what's happened in the last 2 weeks.
Meanwhile, President Trump doubled down on his decision to pardon notorious racist Arizona Sheriff Joe Arpaio during a news conference on Monday.
Sheriff Joe is a patriot. Sheriff Joe loves our country. Sheriff Joe protected our borders. And Sheriff Joe was very unfairly treated by the Obama administration, especially right before an election that he would have won. So, and he was elected many times. So, I stand by my pardon of Sheriff Joe, and I think the people of Arizona who really know him best would agree with me.
There are reports the Trump administration could end the DACA program. That's deferred action for childhood arrivals as early as today. DACA provides legal protections to live and work in the United States for 750,000 young immigrants. We'll have more on DACA later in the broadcast. President Trump is facing new questions about his campaign's ties to Russia amidst revelations a Russian-born real estate developer boasted that a 2015 business deal to build Trump Tower in Moscow would help get Trump elected president of the United States. In an email to Trump's lawyer, real estate developer Felix Sater wrote, quote, "Our boy can become president of the USA and we can engineer it. I will get all of Putin's team to buy in on this. I will manage this process," unquote. At the time, the Trump Organization was pushing to build a massive Trump Tower in Moscow. Sater claimed to have secured financing for the project with VTB Bank. In New York City, more than 100 residents and supporters rallied outside the Holyrood Episcopal Church in Washington Heights for a candlelight vigil to support an undocumented woman who's taken sanctuary to avoid deportation to Guatemala. 33-year-old Amanda Morales Guerra is the mother of three U.S.-born children, Dulce, Daniela, and David. She's been living in the United States since 2004. She went into sanctuary earlier this month to defy the Trump administration's order that she report to the Immigration and Customs Enforcement Office with a one-way ticket back to Guatemala. She's the first person to publicly take sanctuary in New York City since Trump took office. Immigration rights activists say about a dozen more undocumented immigrants are quietly taking sanctuary in the tri-state area. And those are some of the headlines. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman.
And I'm Juan Gonzalez. Welcome to all of our listeners and viewers around the country and around the world. The death toll is rising as massive amounts of rain from Hurricane Harvey continue to flood Houston and other parts of Texas and Louisiana. The Houston police and Coast Guard have rescued over 6,000 people from their homes, but many remain stranded. Meteorologists forecast another foot of rain could fall on the region in the coming days. Harvey, which is now a tropical storm, is heading back to the Gulf of Mexico and is expected to make landfall again on Wednesday.
So much rain has already fallen that the National Weather Service has had to add, U.S. has been talking to North Korea and paying them extortion money for 25 years. Talking is not the answer, unquote. On Thursday, the U.S. flew two nuclear-capable B-1 bombers near the demilitarized zone separating North and South Korea, accompanied by South Korean fighter jets. Meanwhile, North Korean state media warned its test of a new missile fired over Japan this week was a prelude to more military operations directed at the U.S. territory of Guam. Back in Texas, a federal judge Wednesday blocked implementation of Texas's new anti-immigrant law just 2 days before it was set to take effect. The ruling by U.S. District Judge Orlando Garcia is temporary and will give opponents of the law time to mount a court challenge. SB 4 would make it a misdemeanor for local police to limit cooperation with federal immigration agents. It also would ban sanctuary cities in Texas and allow officers to ask about the immigration status of anyone they detain. The law's scheduled implementation raised concerns that many immigrants in Texas are not coming forward to seek help amidst the flood from Hurricane Harvey because they fear being detained and deported.
The physical infrastructure was damaged.
Hurricane Irma, the most powerful storm ever recorded over the Atlantic Ocean, has left at least 10 dead in the Caribbean, more than a million without power in Puerto Rico, and the entire island of Barbuda virtually uninhabitable. It's now barreling toward the Dominican Republic, Haiti, and then Florida. Meanwhile, much of the Pacific Northwest is on fire, and the death toll from Hurricane Harvey has risen to 70. While President Trump speaks in North Dakota, celebrating his decision to pull out of the Paris Climate Accord and green light the Dakota Access and Keystone XL pipelines.
In order to protect American industry and workers, we withdrew the United States from the job-killing Paris Climate Accord. Job killer. People have no idea. Many people have no idea how bad that was. And right here in North Dakota, the Dakota Access Pipeline is finally open for business.
We'll speak with 350.org co-founder Bill McKibben about the killer hurricanes and climate change. Then as tensions continue to escalate between North Korea and the United States, we'll go to South Korea, where hundreds are protesting the deployment of THAAD missiles and the militarization of the Korean Peninsula. Finally, is Nobel Peace Prize laureate Aung San Suu Kyi presiding over a genocide against Rohingya Muslims in Burma?
They burned our houses. We could not take our belongings. We were hiding near a hill for 2 days. We were there in the rain without food and with my children. When we heard the sound of shooting, we took a boat and crossed the sea to come here to Bangladesh.
All that and more coming up. Welcome to Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman. In the Caribbean, at least 10 people are dead after Hurricane Irma, the largest Atlantic hurricane on record, brought devastation to small islands as it barreled towards the Dominican Republic, Haiti, Cuba, and South Florida. The eye of the Category 5 storm struck the islands of St. Martin and Anguilla Wednesday with sustained winds of 185 miles an hour, leveling more than 90% of all structures. On Barbuda, the prime minister declared the island practically uninhabitable and warned the entire population may need to be evacuated as another storm, Hurricane Jose, could strike over the weekend. In Puerto Rico, more than a million people have lost power, as authorities warned some areas could be dark for up to 6 months, partly because the island's electrical infrastructure has gone neglected due to Puerto Rico's debt crisis. In Haiti, hundreds of residents at a tent city in the capital city, Port-au-Prince, who were left homeless after the 2010 earthquake, appealed to the government for shelter from the approaching storm.
I have no place to go. I have to stay here. I will live or die depending on how this storm hits us.
If God wants to help us, he will, but we have no place to go.
In Florida, more than 100,000 people have been told to evacuate their homes as some computer models predict Hurricane Irma could make a direct hit on Miami as a Category 4 storm. Climate scientists say warmer ocean temperatures due to climate change likely adds to Hurricane Irma's power. We'll have more on Hurricane Irma and climate change after headlines as we speak with climate activist Bill McKibben. In Texas, family members of prisoners in the flood-ravaged city of Beaumont say their loved ones were left for days in flooded cells with inadequate food, water, and medical care after prison officials failed to evacuate them ahead of Hurricane Harvey. According to at least seven relatives of prisoners at the Beaumont Federal Correctional Complex, some cells filled with water caught deep. Temperatures spiked to nearly 100 degrees as air conditioners failed, and prisoners wrapped towels over their noses to avoid the stench of sewage from backed-up toilets. In Washington, D.C., the House of Representatives voted 419-3 Wednesday to provide nearly $8 billion in initial emergency aid for relief and rebuilding from Hurricane Harvey as Texas struggles to recover from what's set to become the most expensive natural disaster in U.S. history. The relief bill is on track to go to President Trump for his signature by Friday, just ahead of Hurricane Irma's expected landfall in South Florida. President Trump traveled to North Dakota Wednesday to pitch a tax plan that would overwhelmingly favor the wealthiest Americans while touting his administration's role in slashing environmental protections and promoting the fossil fuel industry. Trump made the remarks at an oil refinery in Mandan across from the Missouri River from the state capital, Bismarck.
In order to protect American industry and workers, we withdrew the United States from the job-killing Paris Climate Accord, job killer. People have no idea. Many people have no idea how bad that was. And right here in North Dakota, the Dakota Access Pipeline is finally open for business.
President Trump also touted his move to reauthorize the Keystone XL pipeline, which would carry more than 800,000 barrels of tar sands oil per day from Alberta, Canada, to U.S. refineries. President Trump struck a three-month deal Wednesday with congressional Democrats to raise the ceiling on the national debt, postponing a looming fiscal crisis and shocking members of Trump's own party, including his own White House aides. The deal left Republicans fuming, including Tennessee Senator Bob Corker, who last month questioned Trump's competence and stability. The agreement sets up a showdown on the federal borrowing limit in December. 15 states and the District of Columbia sued the federal government Wednesday by seeking to block President Trump's plan to end DACA, the Deferred Action for Childhood Arrivals program, which gives nearly 800,000 young immigrants permission to live and work in the United States. Among those pressing the suit is New York Attorney General Eric Schneiderman.
We understand what's going on in Washington, and we know that when bullies step up, you have to step to them and step to them quickly. And that's what we're here to do today. By definition, dreamers play by the rules. Dreamers work hard. Dreamers pay taxes. For most, America is the only home they have ever known. They deserve to stay here.
Trump's cancellation of DACA, which was announced Tuesday by Attorney General Jeff Sessions, set off mass protests in cities around the country. In Washington, D.C., Wednesday, activists outside the Department of Justice building toppled a Confederate monument-style effigy of Jeff Sessions perched atop a cardboard pedestal labeled Living Monument of White Supremacy. In South Korea, back in the U.S., a federal court struck another blow Thursday to President Trump's ban on refugees and visitors from six majority Muslim nations. The unanimous ruling by three judges on the Ninth Circuit Court of Appeals rejected an attempt by the Trump administration to deny visas to grandparents, aunts, uncles, and cousins who wish to travel from the affected countries to join relatives living in the U.S. The Justice Department said it'll challenge the latest ruling on the travel ban when the Supreme Court hears the case next month.
Okay, so what we need to appreciate is that today's session is going to be covering the native dimension to immigration and citizenship. All too often when we refer to the United States as a nation of immigrants, when we deal with native peoples, they're dropped from the discourse. Yet it is their homeland that every immigrant group will eventually come to occupy. So one of the important things to deal with in this course is the Native people's experience. We need to appreciate that. By understanding Native experiences with their environment and then their eventual removal from their homelands, we can come to an appreciation of why every citizen of the United States must give thanks to the original inhabitants of this land. Many times, the original inhabitants welcomed immigrants, but most often throughout history, they were forced through war to make room for immigrants. So in this presentation, we are going to appreciate Native people's rich traditions, which form the basis or foundation of U.S. society in our existence today. So let's recognize the importance of migration in Native North America. People have been in constant motion throughout the North American continent, especially the area known as the Southwest United States and Northern Mexico today. And they've been in movement since ancient times. People have been going back and forth across the present-day U.S.-Mexico border and all borders of nations in the Western Hemisphere since time immemorial. So let's understand that the region and the people reflect a diversity that is prevalent today. So, Kuru, if you could put down below migration. Migration is the term that we need to appreciate here. The present-day United States has been home to culturally diverse populations since time immemorial. The U.S. contains an environmental and a geographic diversity that is impressive and awe-inspiring. Native peoples developed specific linguistic heritages reflecting their interaction with the environment. And since time immemorial, people have uniquely responded to the environmental and the geographic diversity of what is commonly referred to by Native populations as our Mother, the Earth, or as the Haudenosaunee call North America, Turtle Continents. Now, for 30,000 years, Native communities developed techniques by which to appreciate all that the Earth has to offer. Societies that depended on some combination of hunting with, combined with fishing and the harvesting of plants. Well, we often call these societies simple societies, or in anthropological terms, hunting and gathering societies. And basically, the reason why those simple terms are used to identify these communities is, of course, because they do not have complex social and political forms that are afforded by more productive economies. So when we take a look at these communities, the intimate knowledge of an area, its resources, and its the techniques required for using the resources, for using them successfully, are anything but simple in what are known as subsistence communities. Indeed, they often call for a variety of skills and a degree of technical ingenuity on the part of the average adult that is considerably greater than that required in our push-button civilization. Now, since the archaic period, people established rituals and traditions that revealed a fine sense of interpersonal relations. And these relations were reached for maintaining group cohesion. And it was group cohesion that was necessary for survival. So they developed what ethnobotanists refer to as ecologically sensitive subsistence techniques. So if we could put that in the bottom thirds, subsistence societies, subsistence economies. Again, ecologically sensitive subsistence techniques. These economies are very important. Subsistence economies. They reveal an effective use of the environment with a personal participation in the world. And this is the basic scheme of life for people into modern times. And basically, with regards to subsistence communities, you are responsible for the group, not to yourself. Your survival is based on the consideration for the welfare and feelings of others and the environment. And so the key to recognizing this unique relationship with the earth is the people's religion. All Native societies will come to develop what religious scholars label as a nature ethics. A nature ethics. And this is very important. Their attitudes towards the environment reflects ethical relations with the plant and animal worlds and with other humans. So again, if we could put nature ethics at the bottom here. Ethics. What are ethics? Ethics can be defined as limitations of freedom based on the consideration for the welfare and feelings of others and the environment. You are not free to dump battery acid in a stream. You're not free to do your number in a pond. You must appreciate your surroundings. You must become a member of the environment, because you have to understand that the earth has rights. The animals and the plants have rights to exist just as humans. Native peoples are going to develop an oral history to assert their connection to the earth, to assert indeed their connection to the universe. So they identified with their environment by respecting what are known as sacred sites. And since the archaic period, generations made utilitarian art forms. These were art objects that were used for personal consumption. They did this by fashioning tools that were made from stone and antlers. They weaved ropes, they wove ropes into, they wove fibers into ropes and fishnets. And they fashioned pottery. Let's listen to a contemporary Pueblo artist explain for us the importance of respecting these sacred sites. Crew, let's go to film clip number 2 on nature ethics.
I have gone many places, but this is the place that feeds me. I'm closest to the mountains. I see the openness of the sky. Every day I can look out my studio window and see these trees, and they have history with my father, with other people in this community. I belong here. This is where I belong. The people that I come from say that they grow out of the ground, that they emerge from the ground. I believe that. This is where I came out of. The commitment in the prayer that we make to Clay Mother, to Nachuquicho, is that eventually we will be back into her womb. And that's exactly what I believe will happen to me. So that I'm here now, out of the ground, and living my life, but at some point I'll go back. And this is the way I want it to be. When you first go up into the mountains to get the clay, it's golden with the clay, micaceous glitter. I never heard of this place before, except my mother brought me here once, and when we came to this area, when we drove up on the dirt road, she got really excited because she wanted to show me exactly this glitter. I especially like the way this feels and looks on brown skin. It almost becomes part of my skin. Even after I've washed my hands, I can see the glitter, and it reminds me of this place. When I come here, I'm excited. I'm like a child because nothing can hurt me. No one is going to say anything mean to me here. And everything is so beautiful and peaceful and perfect, so that I just open up. And that's exactly what we're supposed to do. That's exactly what I'm looking for when I'm going to create, is that I'm opening up. I'm opening up to this force that I'm not afraid of, and that I can just let myself fall into it and just be able to be inspired and think about the people I love and think about the things around me, so that when I go back to my home and my studio, I carry this with me, and that I'm able to create and open up again and just let it all flow into those vessels I'm making. Okay, 1, 2, 3. Very familiar and very organic. And I can imagine that my grandmother or my great-grandmother did exactly the same thing on any ordinary day. And I like that connection. Pimpovi, pimpovi, romurankun, kanyena nandan nare sitte, kanyena nandan nare sitte. What I'm doing is I'm taking a material that Pueblo people have historically used for clay vessels, utilitarian and ceremonial, and which of late has become very marketable, because as we know, Indian is a marketable thing. So when I show up with the same material and I'm making these wild pieces that don't have anything to do with their concept of what a Pueblo woman should be making, that disturbs and shakes, so that a lot of people don't know how to deal with that. So, yes, people sometimes don't know or appreciate what it is that I'm doing, but other times I think it has that universal appeal, as I think real creating does.
So, Nora Naranjo Morse, very important Native American artist. I'm using this clip so she can help us appreciate, again, ecologically sensitive subsistence techniques, ecologically sensitive subsistence economies, because these economies practice the nature ethics. Native peoples, again, developed an oral history to assert their connection to the earth, to assert their connection to the universe. And they identify with the environment by respecting what are known as sacred sites. So over the years, the archaic generation, those that lived from 30,000 years ago to about 5,000 years ago, they were in constant motion. They were in constant movement. And the people's botanical knowledge allowed them to either search for and or locate and inventory and use every existing food resource that the earth has to offer. And depending on the environmental topography, the native peoples traveled and took advantage of what was in season. Art forms indicated that they were in relationship with the plants and the animals. And plants became familiar, or the people became familiar, with over 200 medicinal herbs on this continent alone. Today it is understood amongst Native religious leaders and elders that there are about 405 sacred herbs. And perhaps some of those herbs are in your kitchen today. Spearmint or yerbabuena, chamomile or manzanilla, goosefoot or the amaranth. But what the archaic generation left us was a moving, venturing spirit. And they tried all environments. Don't you just like getting into your automobile and traveling throughout this North American continent? But only the archaic peoples used their patamobiles, not automobiles. And people created settled communities in all environments. From the woodlands of the east, which had abundant streams and long shorelines, to the deserts and the plains, where the people by necessity followed seasonal cycles of harvesting foods, complemented by small game hunting. Now, their movements were scheduled. Their movements were purposeful. And every ecological niche on this earth was occupied, and the botanical knowledge, coupled with their spiritual relationships to the plants and the animals, led to sophisticated religious practices. Native peoples celebrated life through dance. Dances in native cultures reveal classifications of human relationship to creation, to God, if you will, to a higher power. Native peoples dance to assert their connection to the environment. Native peoples dance to assert their connection to the universe. And most importantly, they developed a tool that allowed them to move throughout the continent. And this tool is known in Nahuatl as metate y mano, the mortar and the pestle that's used by pharmacists, the molcajete that is found in every Mexican kitchen. It is what I call the first American Express card. You did not leave home without it. So if we could put on the bottom thirds, metate y mano. Metate y mano is very important. The metate y mano allowed people to develop long-distance trading. Olivella shells were carried from the coast of California to the woodlands of the Northeast. Copper was traded out of Lake Superior eastward and southward for hundreds of miles. And the Rocky Mountains obsidian was made into projectile points in Illinois, Wisconsin, and the Midwest, even down into Mexico. Shark and alligator teeth from the warm waters off the Florida coastline were valued as utilitarian art objects in the Ohio Valley as much as it was in the Caribbean. So today's, when we take a look at today's modern freeway system, it is built on the pathways that were created by these peoples. The metate y mano allowed people to move throughout the continent to try all environments. Then something happened around 7,000 years ago. Women became central to the production or to the domestication and production of food plants. And it began in Veracruz, Mexico, where three sisters will appear: corn, beans, and squash. And so an agricultural revolution occurred through the creation of surplus food production. And this agricultural revolution is going to spread north and south from central Mexico. And with surplus food, people are going to be liberated to pursue other activities. While women became agriculturalists, pottery makers, and agents of trade, men went up into the mountains and began gazing at the stars. As they descended, they began to apply their knowledge to their horticultural techniques. Stargazing led to the development of mathematics and science. And the society that became important in the quest for an expansion of knowledge is the Olmec culture that's developed in Veracruz. The Olmecs created a sophisticated calendar system to chart the cycles of the moon. So if we can put in the agricultural revolution around 7,000 before the Common Era, the Olmecs are the benchmark. The Olmecs came to establish a calendar year of 18 months with 20 to 22 days per month. And corn is diffused to all parts of the Western Hemisphere. Meanwhile, hundreds of varieties of domesticated plant potatoes form the basis of subsistence of the Andes Mountains of South America. And potatoes will find their way to the North American continent. So when we take a look at leaders of these complex societies, which flourished, they exacted taxes in the form of goods and services to the state. They recruited labor forces to build irrigation canals and dig ditches. And these activities, in turn, brought more and more land under cultivation to feed ever-growing populations that could build monumental architecture. Monuments were constructed precisely to study the universe. And these monuments were educational centers designed to bring the knowledge of the world into codices. And the people created encyclopedias to document human relations with the earth. They created encyclopedias to document human relationships with the universe. People created many civilizations. And there are examples of numerous civilizations from Mexico to Nicaragua that were expanding and contracting in the areas archaeologists call Mesoamerica. Now, the Mayan culture is the most famous and has been getting tremendous amount of attention simply because of its calendar system. But in the classic period, the era identified as 1 to 1000 AD by archaeologists, cities become centers of trade, and they developed into very powerful territorial states. And the cities epitomized the high cultural achievements of these societies. So let's take a look at cities in long-distance trade and put that down on the bottom, because in what is known as the classic period from 1 to 1000 AD, pyramids, temples, and other monumental architecture are going to be built on an unprecedented scale and in much greater numbers than before along the Mississippi and the Ohio rivers, and across the deserts throughout the South, U.S. Southwest and northern Mexico, into central Mexico, into the jungles and the forests of the Yucatan, down through to Nicaragua, onto the hot desert coasts of Peru, and into the Andean mountains of Peru and Bolivia. What's most important are these societies that concern themselves with regards to surplus food production. They created numerous activities and created urban markets. So one of the things that's important with regards to appreciating these cities, these societies, and what they concern for us in this course is that they developed in North America along with Central and South America. And so when we go along the Mississippi and the Ohio rivers and into the deserts of the United States Southwest, we find the rise of cities and long-distance trade. So we could put cities and long-distance trade, and let's appreciate something about the different cultural attributes of these societies. So let's move to the North American continent, and let's understand the Mississippian culture. So crew, if you could put Mississippian civilizations, and let's appreciate something about the Mississippian tradition. And when we go along the Mississippi, the people of Middle North America create unique societies that flourish in the Ohio, Kentucky area, and between 800 BC to about 600 AD. And these societies are known as the Adena, Hopewell, Mississippian cultures. But these cultures created a series of variations on the same basic cultural tradition. But each civilization has their own historical creation. They just borrowed from each other's tradition. And so let's take a look at how these societies are very important. First, there's this one place called Cahokia. Between 800 and 1,000, these societies experienced increases in population, the appearance of a ranked social organization, the establishment of corn as a major component in the diet, and intra and extra regional trade. These peoples, first there is what is known as Cahokia, which is today eastern, present-day St. Louis. And then there was Etowah, which is present-day Atlanta, Georgia. And then there was Aztalan, present-day Madison, Wisconsin. And the peoples in these societies were multilingual. They followed well-established land and water routes. And they developed a ball game played by teams from different towns, which eventually became the game of lacrosse. Games were accompanied by elaborate ceremonies, dances, rigorous training, and prizes. Warfare was also an important activity. Now, when the Spanish are going to arrive, they're going to visit the region, and they're going to understand that they will appreciate that buildings surrounding the mounds contained what were known as sacred fires, where four logs were arranged so that the space between the logs formed a cross representing the four quarters of the world. The plazas or the courtyards were used for games and ceremonies, and towns varied in size. Major ceremonial celebrations occurred during the solstices and the equinox, and what was most important to appreciate was that this was up and down the Mississippi and into the southeast United States, all the way into Florida, and they had connections to the Caribbean. So let's go to a film clip that helps us appreciate the significance of Cahokia.
If only we could go back in time, we might unravel the mystery of this place. How it was planned, how it was built, what it meant to its people. Now we can see only hints of all that was Cahokia. A huge mound, the largest earthen monument in the Americas, and a vast series of smaller mounds arranged in patterns across the largest archaeological site north of Mexico. There is no other place like Cahokia. We're still learning its secrets, and they point to a far-reaching enterprise, to a people who had a vision for what they would build, and to a city like no other in its time. The valley was rich, naturally abundant. Its fertile soil, laid down by the continent's mightiest river, was hospitable to a vast range of plant species. The river, its floodplain, and the nearby bluffs provided several different habitats for a wide variety of animals. It also became a habitat for human beings who migrated into the area over 12,000 years ago. The people here evolved into a culture we call Mississippian. These were the men and women who built the mounds. Like earlier people, they grew squash, sunflowers, and other seed-bearing crops. Wild plants, fish, and other animals were also important food. But the fuel for their great enterprise was agriculture. When Mississippian communities started growing corn, for example, they could produce more food than they needed, a surplus. Corn grew well here. Crop yields were high. Because corn could be stored for long periods, some could be saved for years when crops were poor. With a steady food supply, great numbers of people could make Cahokia their permanent home. Mississippians could also exchange surplus crops for meat, tools, clothing, or other items. This meant some people didn't have to farm. They could specialize in other activities, such as tool making. So corn and other crops became more than food. They fueled a whole society. The leader might demand a share of corn to use for a variety of purposes. His emissaries might trade their community surplus for rare and exotic goods, such as copper or seashells. Mississippian communities traded in this way over a network that spanned thousands of miles, from the Great Lakes to the Gulf of Mexico, from the Atlantic Ocean to the Ozarks. All of these communities were part of the Mississippian tradition. The larger ones built massive, flat-topped mounds, huge platforms of earth where temples or other buildings were erected. In the American Bottom region, where the Mississippi and the Missouri rivers converge, there was an even more closely linked network. Small communities, some consisting of just a few houses planted at the edge of a cornfield, were linked to larger villages, which were themselves linked to still larger communities, some with thousands of residents. At the center of them all was Cahokia. Cahokia, the great mounds, the vast ceremonial plazas, houses as far as the eye could see. Cahokia. It was the seat of power, of vitality, of wealth, of security. It prevailed for several hundred years. Cahokia. Its many parts were sited with great and deliberate precision. Each area had a function. There were enormous plazas for games, ceremonies, and great gatherings. There were miles of stockade wall protecting the central ceremonial area. There was a unique sun calendar that we call Woodhenge. There were fields of corn and other crops vast enough to feed up to 20,000 inhabitants and produce a surplus. There were immense pits, and from these, earth for the mounds was dug. There were ridgetop mounds marking the city's boundaries. There were flat-top mounds where buildings stood, and there were conical burial mounds. And there was one mound greater than all the others, greater than any other structure in the whole Mississippian world. This great platform of earth was at the center of the community.
Okay, so that's the Mississippian cultures. And the Mississippian cultures took years to develop. They came out of the archaic generation. Years, thousands and thousands of years. So it's not something that just appeared overnight. It was something that the peoples had developed, especially with regards to their ecologically sensitive subsistence techniques. And of course, the creation of a surplus food production, that was the key, what the film was sharing. So the Mississippian cultures flourished, okay? They were very important for our experience, for understanding something about the North American continent. So up and down the Mississippi River and the Ohio River. By the way, the Ohio River, Ohio is pronounced Ohio. It's the Seneca word meaning beautiful waters. The Seneca people that live in the eastern part of Ohio and western part of Pennsylvania called their beautiful waters Lake Erie. Ohio means beautiful waters. So you have these rich, flourishing civilizations arising and developing somewhere right after the archaic generation and after corn has been introduced. So let's understand and appreciate something with regards to that. Now, thank you, Shamin. Shamin has a question. Appreciate Shamin for your participation in the class. You have a question of there were so many different groups in the Americas, how did they develop such similar cultural practices? Well, what we do, what anthropologists have found, and what historians are attempting to appreciate, is that peoples, again, as I shared with you, Shamin, they find commonalities in terms of their relationship to the earth. And that is ecologically sensitive subsistence techniques. Everyone is developing this, especially with regards to nature ethics. This is the common practice that's most often when you take a look at native societies and native peoples today and how native peoples communicate with each other is they understand their respect for the environment. So in that sense. And then when we see the rise of civilizations, as societies began to interact with each other, they began to share their practices. And in fact, thank you for asking that question because that takes us to the next group, and let's appreciate what's going on in the Southwest here, where we're from. The Southwest civilizations that are going to arise that are going to impact California, Arizona, New Mexico, Texas, Colorado, and then the states in Mexico, Baja California, and Sonora, and Chihuahua, and Coahuila, and Tamaulipas, and Nuevo León. All of these are the border states of Mexico. All of these are the border states of the United States. So when we take a look at the Southwest cultures are very important because there's two ways to think of the cultures, and both ways are accurate, but on different levels of generality. So again, keep that in mind, Shamin, with regards to how eventually cultural practices are going to be shared amongst each other. One is to view the area, the entire area, as a series of regional variants of the same basic cultural tradition. All of the cultures depended on the corn, bean, squash triad as the major food base. All of these cultures made excellent pottery and were adept at masonry construction. So to view the entire Southwest as local expressions of one tradition is therefore very reasonable. But this approach yields only partial truth because each culture differs in their origins and they have quite different early histories. And they came only late in their stages of development to achieve a sort of homogeneity through contact, exchange, and here's the key word, migration. What is important to note about the Southwest is that all of these cultures were based primarily on agriculture in a region that's not at all adapted to farming. Permanent water for human use has been and continues to be a crucial problem. So the gardening techniques had to be specially developed to use limited moisture. That's the key. Gardening techniques. So these Southwest gardeners established flourishing, technologically advanced cultures in the least likely place on the continent. We are talking about ingenious ecological adaptations to support large populations. So there's the Mogollon, that first group. By 2000 BC, they are planting a wild pod corn, which is the ancestor of the maize. And later they hybridize that corn with a wild seed grass known as teosintil, and this increases the productivity of the new plant over the original corn. And so this kind of corn is going to be unique to the Southwest, going to be unique to the border areas, because this is what is known as Indian corn. And when you take a look at Indian corn is grown in the four sacred colors of humanity: white, black, yellow, red. And you see that combination in the corn: white corn, black corn, blue corn, red corn, yellow corn. That's known as Indian corn. And so this corn is very sacred. Well, that's the Mogollon culture. The second group is the Hohok. And the Mogollon culture stems from Durango, in the state of Durango in Mexico, into Coahuila, over to Chihuahua, and into New Mexico. That's at over across to the western part, the eastern part of Sonora. That's the Mogollon culture. Then there's the Hohokam culture. The Hohokam culture goes from the Four Corners region, and likewise in the Arizona, Nevada deserts, all the way down to Sonora and Sinaloa, on the border of Sonora and Sinaloa, which are the states just south of Arizona. That's the Hohokam culture. Then there's the Anasazi culture, which is the Four Corners region that covers Colorado, New Mexico, Arizona, and Utah. So we're talking about, these are the three major cultural areas, but there's different other different groups that are just as important. It's just that I'm selecting these three to help us appreciate. Now, there's the Mogollon, they're about 2000 BC. At about 300 BC, there arrives the Hohokam. Their origins are controversial, but they established irrigated agriculture, communal villages, and hand technologies. And then the third group are the Anasazi, and they're the subject of the more romanticized and scientific attention. But for the purposes of this class, let's understand and appreciate specific experiences. Let's go and appreciate something about the Anasazi culture, and let's visit a place called Chaco Canyon.
When we began our migrations, you know, we came up into this world from the world below. The Creator telling the people that there are certain places that you're to live and giving them signs of recognition to where these sites are to be found. The migrations began over probably a period of centuries, always looking for that place that was to be the center of our world.
In this land of extremes, the relentless sun soars temperatures to 110 degrees, parching the earth and quieting all life. 6 months later, frigid winds drop temperatures well below zero in a canyon offering little shelter. And yet here, ancient people chose to construct the center of their world. Buildings of over 700 rooms, originally reaching four stories high. And on top of this tower of stone, they marked with a dagger of light, their knowledge of the sky, a knowledge they would use to guide their construction of a center of cosmology, taking 250 years to complete. The place is a remote canyon in the American Southwest called Chaco. 1,000 years ago, the heart of an ancient Pueblo Indian civilization. These grand buildings have posed a profound mystery for over 100 years of archaeological studies. Why were they built here in this unforgiving place? What was the purpose of their dark enclosed rooms? And of an arrow straight road to the north? And why, after building these majestic structures, did people deliberately seal them and leave? Recent discoveries reveal an intricate astronomical system here. Clues to Chaco have been held over the centuries in these walls and in the oral histories carried by the descendant people, the Pueblo Indians of today.
In our history, they talk of things that occurred a long time ago, of people who had enormous amount of power, spiritual power and power over people. I think those types of people lived here in Chaco.
It's a mystery what attracted people to this spare land. In 850 AD, the arid soil in Chaco Canyon supported only small clusters of subsistence farmers. Traces of their modest earth-sheltered dwellings have all but disappeared, leaving no hint of what was to come. Over the next 2.5 centuries, 10 massive buildings were constructed here, built 4 to 5 stories high and containing 3,000 rooms. At the center, the structure known as Pueblo Bonito grew to cover 3 acres, a space that suggests the grandeur of one of the great public buildings of the world. At its completion, Pueblo Bonito was the size of the Roman Colosseum.
Okay. The Southwest cultures. In this particular case, this is the Anasazi, and taking a specific region known as Chaco Canyon. And Chaco Canyon is in the basin that connects Arizona to New Mexico, or at least it's that area that Native peoples have always visited, that the United States is going to call Arizona and New Mexico. But what's important to appreciate is the interconnectedness of the area, because what this particular documentary shares is that the Southwest is connected to Mexico. The Southwest, likewise, is connected to Cahokia and the Mississippian region. And the entire Western Hemisphere is interconnected. And it took thousands and thousands and thousands of years to come to this interconnectedness. So, again, the Native peoples have always been in movement across these areas. They have been exchanging goods and services, and most importantly, as I shared with you from the beginning, the formation and control of labor forces is key to understanding how these civilizations thrived, because labor forces are constantly moving back and forth what eventually is going to become this border. And so remember, migration is important, especially in Native societies. So one of the things that's most important is to come to this level of complexity. It took thousands and thousands of years. And I just did that within 50 minutes in this class, just trying to share with you a history of interconnectedness of the Western Hemisphere prior to the arrival of Europeans. And so this documentary that I'm using as part of the course, Chaco Canyon, students, you'll be able to watch it and appreciate it. This documentary, I'm using it because it helps us appreciate the spiritual dimension to a people's migration. And I want to emphasize this because all too often we do not take into account a people's spirituality in the decisions made to migrate. And after all, aren't we as human beings constantly involved in the spirit world, asking for direction, especially when making the decisions to move to a new place? So let's understand something basic to Native people's lives once Columbus arrives in 1492, and that is the doctrine of discovery. And so if you could put down on the bottom thirds, Europe and the doctrine of discovery, this is important. The doctrine of discovery is the international law that governed European exploration and the discovery, quote unquote, just the term discovery, of new lands around the world for centuries. So let's understand and appreciate something about racism. The doctrine of discovery is an international legal principle that allegedly granted Europeans first, and then those who are going to become Americans, Euro-Americans, property and sovereignty rights or claims over Native peoples and Native lands, just as soon as Europeans, quote unquote, discovered these lands, and then their progeny, known as Americans, as they discover more lands. And this is the doctrine of discovery. Now, the doctrine plays an important part of American history and modern-day Native American law. The doctrine provided under international law that newly arrived Europeans immediately and automatically acquired property rights in Native lands. And as a result, they gained governmental, political, and commercial rights over the inhabitants without the knowledge or consent of Native peoples. And this is the problems that we still have today with regards to societies and their disrespect for Native traditions. When Europeans and then Americans are going to plant their national flags, are going to plant their religious symbols over newly, quote-unquote, discovered lands, they're demonstrating a legal claim to Native territory. They're telling Native peoples, these are our lands, not yours. It is in this way that nations of the Western Hemisphere, and I'm talking about every nation of the Western Hemisphere, because every nation of the Western Hemisphere is racist towards Native peoples, from Canada all the way down to Argentina, the United States likewise. So all nations of the Western Hemisphere today use the doctrine of discovery as an usurpation or as their right to usurp land for themselves through a legal process. So if Native Americans, of course, if Native peoples resisted these encroachments, well, my goodness, how could they resist Christian civilized European nations? So war is rationalized by Europeans, and then eventually those Europeans that will call themselves Americans, and I'm talking about North Americans, Central Americans, and South Americans, because every American has the prejudice and the biases towards Native peoples. And so, of course, these the means to bring about the legal justification for conquest and colonization is the doctrine of discovery. The doctrine of discovery laid the legal foundation for the occupation of the Western Hemisphere. Once Columbus initiates the encounter between what is referred to as the Old World and the New World, European powers, specifically for our interests, Spain, France, and England, and then the United States, are going to negotiate agreements for the recruitment of labor forces for the expansion of markets. In the process, international accords are going to be written specifically connecting the movement of populations to the expansion of markets. So Spain, France, and England actively recruited populations for the expansion of colonial markets. And their foreign policies incorporated legal instruments to contract and form labor forces. So again, contract and form labor forces, that's the vocabulary word, that we, the concepts that I introduced to you at the beginning of the course. So Spain, England, and France are going to search for labor forces, and they're going to create labor contracting agencies in Europe, then in Africa, and in Asia. And these labor forces are going to find their way to the Western Hemisphere. So these colonial powers had to remove Native peoples to accommodate immigrant populations that were recruited. When the United States was created, the founding fathers inherited the British colonial experience that shaped the way the Constitution approached labor formation, immigration and settlement policy, and of course, native removal. So immigration was tied to labor force recruitment, immigration was tied to labor force participation, immigration was tied to native removal. We never ever understand that. We never ever deal with that when we talk about immigration, okay? So it's very important to understand something about immigration, its relationship to native peoples. Foreign policy was instrumental in securing workers for the expansion of markets. Foreign policy was instrumental for the negotiation of lands and native removal. So, last week we addressed pre-revolutionary immigration, because prior to the creation, or 2 weeks ago, we addressed pre-revolutionary immigration. So prior to the creation of the United States, immigration was so common that colonial governments, the British, the French, the Spanish, and these, they're establishing colonies in the Western Hemisphere, they're establishing colonies in North America and in Mexico and in Cuba and in the Caribbean. So the British, the French, and the Spanish are competing against each other to claim more and more lands, more and more native lands. So as the Spanish, the French, and the British are bringing in more populations, they didn't regulate the flow of these populations. Yeah. Can you imagine, and if you can kind of share my shirt, so you focus in on the shirt, can you imagine, yes, there we go. I like this particular shirt, it's pretty good. Can you imagine leaving it up to native peoples to create an immigration policy? Can you imagine leaving it up to native peoples to create a labor policy? Well, let's go see what happened at Plymouth Rock. Let's go to an interpretive critique of the irony of immigration reform in relationship to the native experience. Let's watch a film clip by Current TV's Super News and appreciate their play with prejudices and stereotypes to get a message across. So, of course, those of you who are watching live, please call in and comment on this particular message. Explain to me the irony of immigration and native rights, and explain to me why I'm wearing this shirt, okay? So let's go, students, let's go, and let's take a look at the immigration debate.
They just keep flooding across our border.
Oh, sure. Come on in. Take our jobs. Eat our corn. See what we care.
And you know, the second they get here, they just start having kids.
Oh, totally. And you know what's worse? They don't use every part of the buffalo.
That's it. Tonight, after the rain dance, we talk to the chief.
Okay, that should give us scattered showers tomorrow with a 75% chance of sun through the weekend.
Chief, every day our borders are being crossed by uninvited foreigners. We have to do something.
Well, if you ask me, and hey, this is just me talking here, I say we shoot them all in the head, make jackets out of their skin, and then leave their carcasses to rot in the sun.
Okay.
Well, I say we welcome them. They're good for the economy, they gave us these comfy blankets, and come on, can anyone here honestly say they don't like fire water?
Didn't they kill your entire family in a raid last week?
Okay, I'll admit there are some cultural differences.
Oh, you pale-faced loving hippie!
Excuse me, but pale-faced seems like a racially charged term. Can we call them something less offensive?
Like what, hugs with trees?
Well, their boots make a cracking sound when they walk. Why don't we call them crackers?
Oh, yeah. From now on, everybody calls white people crackers.
All right, so how do we keep these damn crackers from coming here?
We could build a giant fence to keep the crackers from sneaking onto our land.
Oh, come on. You know those crackers would find some way to sneak in. We need enforcement.
I say we lock their cracker asses up.
Enough. Tomorrow I will issue my ruling directly to the crackers. As protector of the lands between Sacred Bear Mountain and Lake Popozao, I declare the following new laws. All uninvited crackers will now be considered illegal crackers, and we can send them back to where they came from at any time.
Send us back to England?
England? We thought you came from the moon. Furthermore, illegal crackers are now required to register with our guest Indian program. And after living in harmony with the land for at least 6 years, they will be given a junior scout card that must be presented at all trading posts, wigwams, wampum shacks, casinos.
Oh, you've got to be kidding me.
Yes, you can what?
Yes, we can live here and work in this new land.
It's our basic human right.
Well, what about our rights?
And how dare you fly a foreign flag in our country?
And how dare you... What are you, like a Wookiee?
I hate crackers!
It's the Eagles. They have come to bring us wisdom. Shh, listen.
Hey, everybody, just chill out, okay, man?
Everybody friggin' chill.
Chill.
These people aren't immigrating. They're, like, migrating.
Yeah, it's like how we fly south for the winter because it's so friggin' cold.
These people just came here because England sucks. I mean, nobody would live in England if they had a choice, right?
It's too freaking cold there! You know, the freaking country sucks! They freaking come here, you know? What's the big freaking deal?
So if we welcome this new wave of immigrants, no harm will come to us?
Probably not, man.
Yeah, what's the worst that could happen?
And so the Indians lived in harmony with the white man forever. And immigration was never a problem in America again.
Okay, now when you take a look at this comedic interpretation, it highlights the dilemma that Native peoples have historically faced with non-Native populations. Americans who claim their heritage, their birthright heritage to this land, don't understand the Native expression. And this misunderstanding is still with us, and it haunts the Native expression. Because when Columbus did arrive, Columbus set off a chain reaction throughout the Americas. In the 15th century, Europeans are going to introduce diseases such as smallpox and measles that devastated Native communities. Pathogens do not need humans to spread. And once introduced, they can follow established Native trading routes out of the Caribbean and onto the mainland. With Columbus's four voyages, pathogens will engulf the Caribbean, enter Florida, Guatemala, and Venezuela, prior to the arrival of colonial settlers. So as Native peoples adjusted to the changes, there were specific groups of people moving through an area known as the Great Plains. And basically, these people were moving around what came to be known as the grasslands of the earth, lands that stretched from the borders of Texas and Coahuila and Tamaulipas in Mexico, all the way north through the Dakotas into Canada, all the way east over into Ohio, and west into the Colorado Plateaus. The Kiowa, the Comanche, the Navajo, the Apache, and others are going to follow seasonal cycles of water, and they adjusted their lifestyles around the buffalo. So when the Spanish arrive in the Southwest, they're going to introduce the horse, and eventually this important animal will lead to the creation of what will be known as the Plains horse culture, leading to, again, the significance of migration. So let's listen to a documentary on how the horse influenced the migration patterns of important Native societies occupying the area known as the Great Plains. Let's go to that documentary.
People have occupied the Americas for perhaps as long as 40,000 years. Over these years, they have created great civilizations equaling any found in Europe, Asia, and Africa. In North America, Paleo-Indians hunted the mammoths and mastodons. They were replaced by archaic Indians, who lived from 5,000 to 1,000 BC. They left behind remarkable cave art. In at least one instance, they hunted bison, the species known as the American buffalo, by driving them into kill sites on the eastern Colorado plains. But these hunter-gatherers were moving towards becoming agricultural societies. Prior to the arrival of Europeans in 1492, the transition to agrarian cultures had been nearly completed. Indian nations extended across North America. A network of cities flourished as a part of a mound-building culture in the East. In the Southwest, the Anasazi and their contemporary cultures built equally remarkable dwellings. Then, in the historical blink of an eye, they all disappeared and were replaced by the configuration of tribes in place at the start of the 17th century, many of which then vanished as a result of European diseases and settlement. During this time, the great cities were replaced by small agricultural villages. Then, as the Europeans expanded across the continent, the surviving tribes were pushed ever westward into a constantly redefined and shrinking Indian territory. However, during the middle of the 18th century, two parallel events occurred on the North American continent: the creation of a new type of nation, the United States of America, and the creation of a new kind of Indian culture, the warrior horse culture. Two remarkable human transformations that would eventually clash in bitter conflict. Two large mammal species played an equally critical role in creating the remarkable Plains Indians culture. One was the horse, an animal brought to the New World by the Europeans. The other, a member of the cattle family, was the American buffalo, indigenous to the continent. The American buffalo can trace its ancestry back to the Pleistocene era, when its relatives roamed among the mastodons, mammoths, giant wolves, and lions. In fact, the buffalo is the lone survivor from that ancient time. A herd animal, the buffalo is covered with long, dark brown woolly hair. It has a massive head, high humped shoulders, and a tufted tail. Fully grown, buffaloes are 5 to 6 feet high at the shoulders and can weigh as much as a ton. Like other members of the cattle family, they thrive on grasses. Prior to the 1800s, it is estimated that the buffalo population ranged somewhere between 60 to 80 million. They were found wherever prairie grasses grew, from Canada to Texas, and from the Rockies to Ohio and Kentucky. It was said that when one of the vast herds moved through an area, it kicked up a cloud of dust, darkening the sky. For 10,000 years, buffalo had been hunted on foot by the Native American tribes, but were never the principal source of food and material for the Indian, as the deer or elk were. That changed with the arrival of the Europeans and their horses. The horse was particularly important to the Spanish in their conquests and explorations. The Spanish Iberian Mustang was not a huge grain-fed animal like the horses from northwestern Europe and the British Isles. It was a desert-bred animal that could live entirely off grasses and go for long periods without water. It was capable of carrying a man in heavy armor over miles of burning desert and dry high plains. In 1680, there was a massive uprising by the Pueblo Indians against their Spanish overlords. When the surviving Spanish fled, they left behind their sheep, cattle, and horses. The Pueblo, a sedentary people having little use for the thousands of Spanish horses, simply let them roam free. These horses, thriving on the short grass prairies, formed the nucleus of the great Mustang herds of the Southwest and Southern Plains. This great horse dispersal produced perhaps the most rapid cultural transformation hitherto ever witnessed on the planet. Within 100 years, a number of Native American tribes on both sides of the Great Plains had transformed themselves into nomadic, buffalo-hunting horse cultures. Horse cultures with names like the Cheyenne, the Sioux, the Comanche, the Kiowa, and the Arapaho. After the great horse dispersal started, most of the remaining North American tribes had horses, but only a few tried the grand economic experiment of developing a true nomadic horse culture. At the same time, the short grass prairie offered a huge unoccupied region for expansion. While unfit for permanent settlement, it was ideal for any group that moved easily with the wanderings of the millions of buffalo. The horse provided the vehicle, and the buffalo provided a virtually inexhaustible supply of high-quality protein, giving the tribes willing to venture onto the plains the chance for rapid population growth. Each of these tribes has a unique story of its transformation into a horse culture. The why has long been lost, but the journey has been recorded. Looking at the Great Plains as a sea of prairie grass, all the eventual nomadic tribes started in the north, three from the eastern shore and four from the western shore. Unlike the other horse cultures, the Navajo and Apache moved into their 18th and 19th century homelands prior to the arrival of the Europeans in the 16th century. They were part of a very large subarctic group generally referred to as the Athabascan-speaking Indians. Their ancestral home covered a large part of Canada's Northwest Territory. Anthropological records indicate these people lived in small family groups, were nomadic, and hunted caribou. Sometime between 900 and 1400 AD, a group identified...
Okay. Now, the impact of the horse on Native traditions in the Great Plains was significant. It is important to realize how the horse will become crucial to the success rate of Native resistance to first the Spanish, then the Mexican nation, and then finally the United States, and all of them have colonization plans on Native lands. So in Texas, the Kiowa and Comanche are going to use the horse most effectively in their hit-and-run techniques against the colonization programs of both Spain, the United States, and eventually Mexico. The Kiowa and the Comanche are going to develop the raiding complex to perfection. But, you know, that is a U.S. and Mexican historian approach to Native peoples. What I call the raiding complex is that the Native peoples are going to create their most effective border patrol to stop both Mexican as well as American settlers from moving in into their lands. And they had an effective border patrol through the horse culture. But it is only through the advancement of industry, the onslaught or the arrival of the railroad, and then eventually the genocidal slaughter of the buffalo that will bring these plain horse cultures to a standstill. It's not until the 1870s when Quanah Parker is removed to Oklahoma and Geronimo is captured in Arizona will a sense of community for arriving immigrants, will a sense of permanency be established for arriving immigrants between San Antonio to San Diego, between Coahuila and Sonora up to Kansas. So the appearance of the horse created new movements of populations along the plains, and it increased the trade in buffalo products in the Southwest. And this is very important with regards to appreciating something about the Native tradition, because it is this that Hollywood has a fascination over that they call the Wild Wild West. So, the United States at the outset is not going to recognize Native peoples as part of the new experiment in nation building. Please understand this. So, when we talk about President Trump and the racist approach that he has towards policy, well, President Trump is just being what all white people wanted, was a president that wasn't afraid to say that whites are superior. Okay? That's all what white people wanted. That's why they voted for President Trump. Okay. So when we take a look at this nation, it, you know, President Trump is just approaching what this nation was founded upon: white superiority, white racism. And we can just go to understand something about Thomas Jefferson. Because, in fact, Thomas Jefferson is going to familiarize himself with the doctrine of discovery. And Thomas Jefferson is going to write one of the most racist statements that are that's enshrined as part of the Declaration of Independence. This sacrosanct document that sits in the Smithsonian Institute that is guarded, that has a military person guarding it. That's how much all everybody goes and bends their knees at this document called the Declaration of Independence. Because in this document, there's the racism. Merciless Indian savages. The school children are going to learn very early in their lives the prejudice and the racism of the founding fathers of this nation. Native peoples will not be accorded the rights and privileges of citizenship in the 19th century. Now, in the first week of this course, I introduced you to the concepts concerning the racialization process. I shared with you that racism is an instrument of power used by those in power to perpetuate their power. And Thomas Jefferson knew very well what he was doing when he phrased merciless Indian savages into the Declaration of Independence. Because in that Declaration of Independence, it says, merciless Indian savages whose known rule of warfare is an undistinguished destruction of all ages, sexes, and conditions. And it was this man that's going to lay the foundation for the removal of native populations. So as you follow the logic of prejudice, of stereotype, and avoidance, and then you move down to the next level of discrimination and having the law behind you to the means of action to carry out the discrimination to leave a population disadvantaged, and then you follow the logic again of segregation and then eventually creating a law to segregate that's isolated a population, well, what is next? How does a society come to hate? And so, of course, the next is U.S. policy. Did the United States commit genocide? What is removal all about? So let's talk about this concept known as genocide. Okay? And that's what removal is all about. Now, I'm going to be asking you not only to watch a film called Chaco Canyon so you can understand the spiritual migration of people, I'm going to ask you to read a chapter on the indigenous experience specifically related to removal, because now what's going to happen is that not only was there a spiritual migration, now there's going to be a forced migration of Native peoples from their land. And this particular president, one of the most racist presidents ever, perhaps maybe Donald Trump can try to match the racism of this particular president, President Andrew Jackson, who was a reactionary just like Trump, who reacted to everything, especially took everything personal, just like Trump. President Jackson implemented a policy known as Indian Removal Act, which challenged all Native peoples east of the Mississippi River to move west. He told them, just get out. The Cherokee experience with the removal is known as the Trail of Tears. And perhaps that's been given the most romantic attention with regards to the Cherokee. They refer to it as tears because on their way to being removed to what is known today as the state of Oklahoma, they shed their blood along the trail. They shed their children and their elders. Let's visit a film clip assisting us in visualizing the removal process. Let's listen to what happened to the Cherokees.
Sawiga Dante. Idi yang we yang. Ale long hitch. Askin he gun. Teta da doska. Ahane hand, Hawin, Gato, Wuni Los, a gun you then a sky cannot do doy. Ale a gun you then a gay sailor to doy. Askin he gun. He got a slant no hand. Slant a long hay you, Gandina, the yig. Gardo. Ale, Ali eat asked of the yig. Askin he goes again. I said no. No, the land of canoes to me, dole. You want this at in gown? President Andrew Jackson.
Thank you.
Okay, so the United States has a history of deportation. In this particular case, it was Native peoples, and they deported them, or they had an out-migration from their particular lands. And this has been the history with regards to Native peoples. And again, how does a society come to hate? Well, Thomas Jefferson set it in motion when you take a look at this Declaration of Independence. It says, merciless Indian savages. Please understand that. So when we talk about racism, especially with regards to Trump and immigration policy, let's just know that the United States has its history with regards to Native peoples. So when the United States is going to take over Mexico and take over half of its territory and take it away from Mexico, and they're going to call it California, Arizona, New Mexico, and Texas, along with Colorado, the Native peoples likewise are going to encounter a policy of removal. So the Navajo and the Apache are going to be formidable groups who resisted both Mexico and the United States' economic expansion. So let's appreciate what happened to Navajo. The Navajo likewise have an experience with genocide. Their experience with genocide is known as Bosque Redondo. In Bosque Redondo, the Navajo have a long history of interaction, intermingling, miscegenation, and raiding with Spanish, Mexican, Apache, Comanche, Ute, Pueblo, and eventually Anglo-American people. And their traditional homeland, Dinetá, covers an area that encompasses northeastern Arizona and western New Mexico. So if we could put Bosque Redondo in the 1864 Navajo Long Walk, because right after the U.S. war with Mexico, conflicts escalated between Navajos and Americans coming into their lands. And after a series of failed treaties with the U.S. government, resistance groups under the leadership of Manuelito and Barbosinto in the 1860s demanded reparations for the loss of sacred lands, the right to subsistence existence, and the return of grazing lands to reserve their economic livelihood based on sheep grazing. So after some confusion over a dispute over about the winner of a horse race, a shot rang out and murder and death ensued. With the Civil War in progress at the time of the conflict, the Union Army had to concern itself with the Confederates instead of the Navajo question. Orders were eventually given to Kit Carson to effect a Navajo surrender on July 20, 1863, and when the Navajo refused to surrender, Carson ordered a scorched earth campaign to starve the Navajo into submission. Now, despite the resistance efforts of Manuelito, thousands of Navajos surrendered. Carson immediately initiated what the Navajo referred to in their history as the Long Walk. And in January of 1864, between 8,000 to 9,000 people were sent to concentration camps. And over 200 are going to die on a 300-mile stretch that took 18 days to travel by foot. And basically, it was elders and children who could not keep up with the march, and they were just shot right on sight. And the people were to be relocated to Fort Sumner in an area called Bosque Redondo, which in Spanish means a round grove of trees, in the Pecos River Valley, which is in Texas. There, the Navajo will meet their traditional enemy, who were facing the same federal removal policy, the Mescalero Apache. Despite the government's attempt to create the first Indian reservation west of Indian Territory, the Mescalero and Navajo faced starvation, disease, and death. And by 1868, the United States realized that it was committing genocide, and so they created a treaty that was allowed for the relocation of Navajo and Mescalero back to their current reservations. But and let me just share with you that every state has its history of Native removal. Every state has its history of genocide, and California is no exception, because in California, they literally called it Indian hunting season, where you can go out and just kill a Native American to get their lands. And so the most atrocious of all experiences is what is known as the Sand Creek Massacre of November 29, 1864. This is the ultimate act of genocide that was committed by a 700-man force of the Colorado Territory Militia. It was under the leadership of this particular man, Colonel John Milton Shivington. He was a Methodist preacher and an anti-slavery advocate, but he sent 800 troops of the 1st and 3rd Colorado Company and volunteers from the 1st New Mexico Company, and he sent them into a Northern Cheyenne camp under the leadership of Black Kettle. An American flag and a white flag of peace flew over Black Kettle's lodge, but Shivington was anxious for a fight, and what happened, all of his soldiers got drunk and they went in and they committed genocide. Shivington bragged that he killed 500 to 600 warriors, but the Cheyenne counted 53 men and 110 women and children dead. In fact, 15 Colorado militiamen were killed and 50 were wounded, not from native retaliation because they didn't have any arms, but from friendly fire caused by drunken behavior. The militia plundered the camp and left no one alive. They dressed their weapons, hats, and military regalia with body parts. Fetuses were ripped out of pregnant women, and male and female genitalia were used to cover their saddles. Women's clitorises were wrapped around saddle horns. Pubic hair garnished holsters and belts. And they traveled to Denver and they displayed their battle trophies to the population. A congressional committee investigating the massacre condemned the atrocities, but no one was punished. The U.S. conveniently washed its hands of the atrocity. So after the Civil War, the United States went on a protracted program of annihilation of Native peoples west of the Mississippi. Today, we appreciate the wars Hollywood gives us as wagon trains made their way west to tame, quote unquote, the wilderness filled with savages. John Wayne, Kevin Costner, and yes, equal opportunity to blacks, Will Smith, have popularized the Wild West in the American imagination. This is civility versus savagery. The wilderness needs to be tamed by courageous people. Today, the U.S. military, the CIA, and the National Security Council still uses the concepts of taming the wild in their descriptions of policies against enemies. We haven't ended it. We have Tomahawk missiles, Apache helicopters, Comanche drones, and of course, in Obama's administration, with the capture of Osama bin Laden, it was called Operation Geronimo. So let's go to one of the ultimate acts that's known, and that was the Ghost Dance. And the ultimate act was Wounded Knee. Let's go to a film clip. Understand the Ghost Dance as a religious movement that was incorporated into numerous American belief systems, Native American belief systems. The Ghost Dance was first practiced among the Nevada Paiute, and the practice spread throughout much of the western United States, and it quickly reached areas of California and Oklahoma. And as the Ghost Dance spread from its original source, Native American nations synthesized selective aspects of the ritual with their own beliefs. And this process created change in both society that integrated it and the ritual itself. And the chief figure in the movement was this prophet of peace, Jack Wilson, known as Wovoka. Now, different Native cultures incorporated this dance, and Native peoples never called it the Ghost Dance. It is white people who called it the Ghost Dance because they were spooked by the fact that Native peoples were, their spirit world was adjusting to the transformations. Let's go to a documentary that helps us appreciate the dance.
By the late 1880s, a message of hope spread across the Great Plains. It was called the Ghost Dance, a dance to restore the past when Indian nations were free. They danced without rest, on and on. Occasionally, someone thoroughly exhausted and dizzy fell unconscious into the center and lay there dead. The visions ended the same way, like a chorus describing a great encampment of all the Lakotas who had ever died, where there was no sorrow, but only joy, where relatives thronged out with happy laughter. The people went on and on and could not stop. And so I suppose the authorities did think they were crazy. But they weren't. They were only terribly unhappy. Driven off their lands, Indian nations were confined to desolate reservations, dependent on corrupt government agencies for food and supplies.
The people were desperate from starvation. We felt that we were mocked in our misery. We held our dying children and felt their little bodies tremble as their souls went out and left only a dead weight in our hands. Red Cloud, Oglala.
The ghost dance hurt no one, but as it spread, white settlers panicked. The United States government outlawed the dance.
The white men were frightened and called for soldiers. We had begged for life, and the white men thought we wanted theirs.
On a mild day just after Christmas of 1890, a band of Hukwoju Sioux, under their leader Bigfoot, left the Cheyenne River Agency in South Dakota, heading for a meeting at Pine Ridge with Oglala leader Red Cloud. Traveling with Bigfoot were 106 men and 252 women and children. Among them was a boy, Dewey Beard, who would later tell his children and grandchildren about that day.
Grandpa Dewey Beard being the last survivor, I would listen to what he had to say. In a way, it was sad, and yet it's beautiful because it's bringing back history. One thing that he would say is that had the soldiers, had the government left them alone, in time they would have looked outside and seen how things were changing, and the change would come about from within the bands.
Bigfoot's band was intercepted by the 7th Cavalry. The officer in charge found Bigfoot wrapped in heavy blankets, dying from pneumonia in the back of a wagon. Bigfoot was ordered to make camp along Wounded Knee Creek. In the morning, his people would be stripped of their weapons and escorted to Pine Ridge. Bigfoot made assurances of his peaceful intentions, and the band made camp.
He's a peaceful man. He's always say that, think about the elderly, think about the children and the woman, and don't start the trouble.
Morning broke after a sleepless night surrounded by soldiers. Hukwoju witnesses would later recall what happened next.
Bigfoot, who was sick, came up with a flag of truce tied to a stick. Dewey Beard.
As soldiers trained their guns on them, Bigfoot and his men brought forth all their weapons, placing them near the white flag of truce Bigfoot had planted in front of his lodge. The soldiers then searched their tents and wagons for arms, even confiscating cooking and sewing tools. As Bigfoot's people gathered around the flag of truce outside his tent, four powerful Hotchkiss rapid repeating guns were mounted above the camp.
I noticed that they were erecting cannons up here, also hauling up quite a lot of ammunition for it.
They encircled us like a band of sheep.
I could see that there was commotion amongst the soldiers, and I saw on looking back, they had their guns in position, ready to fire.
Thomas Tibbles, a white reporter who followed the troops to Wounded Knee, recorded what happened next.
Suddenly I heard a single shot from the direction of the troops. Then three or four, a few more, and immediately a volley. At once came a general rattle of rifle firing, then the Hotchkiss guns.
An awful noise was heard, and I was paralyzed for a time. Then my head cleared, and I saw nearly all the people on the ground, bleeding. My father, my mother, my grandmother, my older brother, and my younger brother were all killed.
And he saw his mother walking toward him. She was walking along, and she was shot. Dewey, she said, keep walking, my son. She said, keep going. She said, I'm going to die. And that was the last time he saw his mother.
The women, as they were fleeing with their babies, were killed together, shot right through. And after most of them had been killed, a cry was made that all those not killed or wounded should come forth and they would be safe. Little boys came out of their places of refuge, and as soon as they came in sight, a number of soldiers surrounded them and butchered them there. American Horse, Oglala.
The firing continued for an hour or two, wherever a soldier saw a sign of life. With the sunset, the weather turned intensely cold. About 7 o'clock that night, the 7th Cavalry brought in the long train of dead and wounded soldiers and Indians from Wounded Knee. 49 wounded Sioux women and children had been piled into a few old wagons.
The wounded Indian women and children were eventually carried into an agency church, where they lay in silence on the floor beneath a pulpit decorated with a Christmas banner reading, "Peace on Earth, Goodwill to Men."
Nothing I have seen in my whole life ever affected or depressed or haunted me like the scenes I saw that night in that church. One unwounded old woman held a baby on her lap. I handed a cup of water to the old woman, telling her, give it to the child, who grabbed it as if parched with thirst. As she swallowed it hurriedly, I saw it gush right out again. A blood-stained stream through a hole in her neck. Heartsick, I went to find the surgeon. For a moment, he stood there near the door, looking over the mass of suffering and dying women and children. Oh, the silence. The silence they kept was so complete, it was oppressive. And then, to my amazement, I saw that the surgeon, who I knew had served in the Civil War, attending the wounded from Wilderness to Appomattox, he began to grow pale. This is the first time I've seen a lot of women and children shot to pieces, he said, and I can't stand it. Thomas Tibbles, reporter.
For 3 days, the frozen bodies of the dead, including Bigfoot, lay where they fell at Wounded Knee. Finally, the army dug a large trench at the massacre site. Then, as they collected the bodies, a blanket was seen moving. Beneath it, snuggled against her dead mother, was a baby girl.
Let me just share with you, by the time it was over with regards to Wounded Knee, 150 men, women, and children of the Lakota Sioux had been killed and 51 wounded. Again, some estimates place the number of dead at 300. But 25 troopers also died and 39 were wounded. And it is believed that many were the victims of friendly fire as the shooting took place at close range in chaotic conditions. What's important to understand is that the United States, in this documentary, the United States recruited immigrants to the U.S. Army that were recently arrived from Southern and Eastern Europe and America, and they audaciously performed on behalf of the nation's national interest. So they had already captured the racism, and they went and eliminated the population. Now, once the Native nations are eliminated, the United States begins to implement a policy of benevolence. Because genocide is not a nice word. Assimilation is preferred. So once the U.S. incarcerated Native peoples on reservations, sent them to their concentration camps, a program eventually developed whereby the children would be taken from their parents and sent to a boarding school. So, crew, let's go to the documentary In the White Man's Image, and let's appreciate how the experiment in transforming Native peoples into white persons began. Let's go to forced assimilation policy.
Welcome to the American Experience. I'm David McCullough.
In the last part of the 19th century, it was decided by the national government, with the ardent support of educators, ministers, all kinds of people of goodwill, that the only hope for Native Americans was to turn them into white men, to force them into the great modern mainstream of American life. This wasn't a new idea, but making it official policy was new. Schools were to be the answer. The announcement of one of them, the Haskell Institute in Kansas, said Indian youth from 10 to 18 years of age were to be taught the elements of an English education and the simpler domestic industries, to prepare them to become intelligent, industrious citizens. It sounds good, a worthy program, and in ways it was. Yet the real purpose was to stamp out Native American culture, Indian religion, Indian law, legends, and language, and in that it was often very cruel and short-sighted. Richard Henry Pratt, the dedicated head of the Carlisle Indian School, said he believed in immersing the Indians in our civilization and, when we get them under, holding them there until they're thoroughly soaked. The Carlisle Indian School, which figures at the center of our film, in the white man's image, was founded in 1879, the same year, ironically, when one of the most eloquent men of the age, the great Chief Joseph of the Nez Perce, said this in a famous speech in Washington. We ask only an even chance to live as other men. Let me be a free man, free to work, free to trade where I choose, free to choose my own teachers, free to follow the religion of my fathers, free to think and talk and act for myself.
They were the subjects of an educational experiment carried out with the best of intentions. The experiment gave a new twist to an old saying, the only good Indian is a dead one. It was designed to kill the Indian and save the man.
As Americans, we were to be all alike. And that likeness, unfortunately, was to be white and not Indian.
What was it? Give him a uniform, cut his hair, remove him as far as possible from the center of his real existence, his spiritual existence, put him in a strange place, you know, a place where he has no advantage whatsoever, and he will become what you want him to become. You can draw a picture and let him look at it, and slowly he will transform himself into the image that he sees there.
So the best way to get a culture to transform, of course, is to educate the children in the history of the conquering society. Once you accept their version of your history, assimilation is complete. You are conquered. So an Indian boarding school refers to one of many schools that were established in the United States during the 19th century to educate Native American youths according to Euro-American standards. In some areas, these schools were primarily run by missionaries, but especially given the young age of some of the children sent to the schools, they have been documented as traumatic experiences for many of the children who attended them. So let's go back to the documentary and appreciate what happened to the children at the first boarding school known as in Carlisle, Pennsylvania.
Cold October night, the tired and hungry children arrived at their new home, an abandoned army post in Carlisle, Pennsylvania. This is how Pratt described them to a reporter.
They were the regular blanket Indians. Some of the young men had buffalo robes, and most of them had deerskin leggings worked with beads. Their hair was braided with beaver skin or red flannel, and they wore earrings. They were absolutely wild Indians.
The children spent the first few days sleeping on cold floors with little to eat. And like the exiles at Fort Marion, their Indian identity was about to become a dream.
One of the first things they did was get new names. And they were taken into a room where names were put on a blackboard. And they were asked to choose their own new names. And, of course, didn't know what these names meant or anything, so they were kind of blindly picking their new names. Luther picked his as he might have counted coup on an enemy, he says. He was using the stick to point to his new name as if it were an enemy.
Every fragment of their Indian past was stripped away. Moccasins gave way to leather boots. Feathers and robes to military uniforms. And then it was time for their hair to be cut.
Luther Standing Bear said that he thought when he left home that he would probably do something very, very brave or never, ever return. He actually felt he probably would die. So that's one testimony, but surely many of the children might have felt this, having been taken so far from their families, not entirely understanding what was happening to them, and recognizing that they're powerless.
I felt that I was no more Indian, but would be an imitation of a white man.
The first year at Carlisle was a year of struggle. Food and clothing were in short supply, teachers difficult to recruit, and from all over America came the voices of doubt.
Trying to teach an Indian anything above the barest elements makes no more sense.
You can no more civilize an Apache than you can civilize a rat.
The swine will return to his wallow, the savage to his barbarism.
The only good Indian is a dead one.
Pratt countered his critics with pictures. He commissioned a series of before and after portraits of his students, designed to show their progress from savagery into civilization.
They were half clad, some with only a blanket, dirty, greasy, and all wore a scared look. If all the people who observed them in this condition could only see them after they go through the civilizing process at the school, all prejudice against Indian schools would vanish.
The change is marvelous. It must be seen to be fully appreciated.
The difference is striking, not in the mere change of clothing and improved carriage, but the development of intelligence shown by the faces.
In his mind, I'm sure that Pratt was absolutely convinced that he could take an Indian man and make him a white man through a simple process of changing appearances, changing values. What was it? Give him a uniform, cut his hair, teach him English above all, you know, forbid him from speaking his native language, remove him as far as possible from the center of his real existence, his spiritual existence. Put him in a strange place, you know, a place where he has no advantage whatsoever, and he will become what you want him to become. You can draw a picture and let him look at it, and slowly he will transform himself into the image that he sees there. Well, it doesn't work that way. It's not that simple.
Behind the propaganda lay a different story. Like many Carlisle students, Ernest White Thunder never adjusted to life at boarding school.
Ernest became a kind of non-cooperator. The children were supposed to write to parents or to a relative every week. And when he was asked to do this at one point, he said to his teacher he didn't have any relatives to write to. At one time he had an aunt, but a bear ate her. And so he didn't want to participate in this, but he did write to his father and complain, saying he didn't like what was happening to him at the school. He said, "We are all soldiers now," which he clearly felt bitterly about, and so forth. His father asked him to have a photograph taken of himself. He said, "You say you all look like soldiers now. Have a photograph taken of yourself and send it to me."
Not long after his portrait was taken, Ernest came down with a fever. He refused food, refused medicine, refused to speak to anyone. Pratt worried because Ernest was the son of an influential chief, but there was nothing he could do. In a matter of weeks, the boy was dead.
Pratt wrote a very grief-filled letter to White Thunder, informing him of Ernest's death and saying that he didn't have an image of Ernest that he thought that White Thunder would like, and so his father never did see the photograph that had been made.
Ernest was buried on the Carlisle campus in a cemetery that would later be filled with the graves of hundreds of Carlisle students. Most would succumb to epidemics of cholera, tuberculosis, and influenza. But a few, like Ernest White Thunder, would die of homesickness in a place called Carlisle at the edge of the earth.
Students, and those of you who are out in the audience, I mean, what kind of school has a cemetery? I should share with you something. Boarding schools with cemeteries. Now, as the film reveals, the children were generally forbidden to speak their native languages. They were taught Christianity instead of their native religions, and in numerous other ways forced to abandon their identity and adopt European-American culture. And tragically, many cases of mental and sexual abuse were documented. But ultimately, the forced boarding school era will come to an end in the 1930s. But meanwhile, in the 1924, Congress is going to grant Native peoples citizenship status. So if we can put Native citizenship in 1924, that's very important. Under the 1924 Act, indigenous people did not have to apply for citizenship anymore in the United States, nor did they have to give up their identity as Native peoples to become a U.S. citizen. The 1920 census, after all, revealed that Native peoples represented half of 1% of the total U.S. population. So they were no longer a threat. And so it's going to happen because they were no longer a threat to U.S. society. In the American imagination, they became mascots. Because after all, they're not threatening American way of life. So Native peoples, one of the things that was most important, of course, is when you go hunting, you put your animal heads up there on your wall, so you've got, you know, whatever, you know, buffalo head or lion head or whatever, deer head, whatever, and then there's the Native. So the Natives are up there with the animals, the lions and tigers and Indians, oh my. And Native peoples became mascots because, after all, now, geez, weren't these Native peoples just brave? Weren't these Native peoples, they're lost, they're now part of the American imaginary. And so Native peoples, all peoples know about Native peoples is that they're somewhere up there, especially on Thanksgiving when the Dallas Cowboys play the Washington Redskins. So you've got the Redskins, you've got the Cleveland Indians, you've got the Kansas City Chiefs, you've got all of these, and people just never seen a Native person outside of that. So you have these mascots. And so, of course, this is what happened when we talk about immigration. And so, again, for those of you who are American, if you could just close in on my T-shirt. Again, if you're against immigration, well, then that's fine. When are you leaving? That is the key here. So when we talk about immigration policy, we never really address the Native American issue. But yet it is Native Americans that made room for everybody else. They were forced to make room for everyone else. So please understand that, and that's how we appreciate the red beans. So we've covered the red beans. It is their homeland, which every immigrant group will eventually come to occupy. So I deliberately begin this course with Native people's experiences. So by understanding Native people's experiences with their environment and their eventual removal from their homelands, we can come to an appreciation of why every citizen of the United States must give thanks to the original inhabitants of this land, who at times, as I shared with you, welcomed immigrants, but most often throughout history were forced through war to make room for immigrants. So let's appreciate Native people's rich traditions, which form the basis or foundation of U.S. society and our existence today. Okay, we'll see you next week.